Welcome to tonight's meeting of the Pensions Committee. It's a pleasure to have a couple of new members with us. Welcome. In fact, perhaps we should just go around the room, introduce ourselves, and I'll start and then we'll go around this way. Yeah? So, Councillor Paul Doughty, Chair of Merseyside Pension for Labour, Councillor for Oxton.
I'm John Fulmer, I'm a councillor in St Helens, I represent Moss Bank, and Declaration of Interest, if I may, Chair.
That was a good time.
I'm a scheme member and I'm also a director of Taurus, which is a housing association that I'm a member.
I'm Ian Williams, councillor for Bromley.
Hi, Chair Hillwood, finance director for Borough Council.
Hi, Yvonne Caddick, head of pensions administration.
Guy Hayton, operations and information governance manager at the fund.
Donna Smith, head of finance and risk at the pension fund.
Grant Patterson from Grant Thornton, the external auditors to the pension fund.
Councillor Pat Hackett, representing New Brighton Ward.
Councillor Tony Jones from New Brighton.
Councillor Paulette Lapham from Sefton, representing Sefton Council as a Cabinet Member for Corporate Resources, Compliance and Enforcement.
Councillor Catherine Hodgson, Hesley Ward.
Councillor Andrew Gardner for Lincoln Mills Ward, Wirral, and I will declare that I am a member of the fund.
Oh, I forgot to say I am too.
I'm not, but Councillor Pat Cleary, Green Party Councillor for Brokenham and Shannon.
Pat Phillips, Committee Services.
Colin Hughes, Solicitor.
John Rosen, Independent Chair, Pension Board.
Peter Waller, Director of Pensions.
So, welcome again to all of us, and this is.
Sorry, guys. We do have quite a lot of reports tonight, but most of them are for noting, and we've also got Grant Thornton who is going to do a presentation to us tonight, perhaps available to comment. Okay. We're going to our agenda item 3, audit findings, page 9. Are you actually going to introduce that to us, Donna, or straight into Grant Thornton? Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Chair. In front of you today, you've got our audit findings report for our audit of the pension fund for 17-18, and this really forms part of the overall assurance that you are now seeking at the Pensions Committee to enable you to recommend approval of statement of accounts to Wirral's Audit and Risk Committee, who, from our perspective, are ultimately those charged with governance as the administering authority. However, we have determined to report to you because you have overall responsibility for scheme governance in that sense. So, We're reporting our findings to you tonight in terms of quite on the accounts. Looking primarily, I suppose, at page 3 on our report and page 4, which is page 11 and 12 in your packs, we haven't identified any adjustments that would affect the fund's overall financial position for the year ended 31st of March, and that's net assets of just over £8.5 billion. In terms of, we did receive the financial statements and working papers in accordance with the agreed timescale, and I'm sure the members appreciate this is the first year of bringing forward the timescale of the audits to the end of July across the whole sector. And again, the accounts were prepared to a good standard, so we'd like to thank Donna, her team, and the Royal Council as well in terms of their overall support that they provided. As I say, we haven't identified any significant issues that we need to bring to you in terms of financial statements. I'll come on to one adjustment that you just need to be made aware of in the accounts in a moment. We have nearly finished our audit. We've got some elements outstanding, some of which are, if you were here before as members, in terms of outstanding a small number of queries relating to third-party confirmations. And once they come through, we can finalise our work there. You have the management representation letter in front of you today, so you'll be recommending that, so we will need to see the final signed version of that. And part of our overall audit closure model, we'll be looking at a final set of financial statements and the annual report once approved. And then what we do need to do is, if you would suppose, update our work to the point of signing, which is about 10 days time away, something like that. So if you look onto page 12 of your pack, just in terms of materiality, we didn't change anything from our plan of materiality or elements like that. So we didn't have to change any significant parts of our plan. Our work did cover an evaluation of the controls environment and testing of elements of benefits payments and significant transactions. And there's no significant issues coming out of that work. If I move you on to page 5 or page 13 in your pack, we did identify significant audit risk in relation, well, we rebutted the presumption of revenue recognition. We did test material income transactions, and there was nothing coming out of that work that suggested that a rebuttal was incorrect. We've undertaken journals controls, and we're satisfied we have no evidence of management override. And the one element of significant risk where there's an element of judgment is around your level 3 investments or infrastructure assets, elements like that, private equity. We've undertaken work on those, and we haven't identified any significant issues that we need to bring to your attention. As members of the committee, you probably will be surprised, the other elements we focus on are contributions that you receive as a fund and the pensions benefits payable. Again, our testing is outlined there, and we haven't found any issues that we need to bring to your attention. And the other element of valuation, which is now on page 15 of your report, is around what we call level 2 investments, and they're mainly your protective investment vehicle, your pooled investment vehicles. And again, we've conducted testing on the valuation of those and answer that, and again, nothing to report to you. On page 16, we outline your accounting policies, and we're satisfied that you've got appropriate accounting policies in place. And on page 9 and page 17, I am required under standards to report certain elements to you, and they're outlined there. We've retained, as I said, we're still waiting some third-party confirmations, but there are no significant issues there that I need to bring to your attention. We will be completing a consistency opinion on the annual report once we've finalised our work on the pension. Page 18 outlines that we remain independent of yourselves as a fund, as a firm. And on page 19, which is page 11 in our report, is one adjustment I just need to bring to your attention. In terms of when we were undertaking our testing, we found a misclassification error in terms of income. That was mainly, the main one error we found was in relation to Schroeder's investment income, which you'd classified as dividend from equities, whereas actually it's a bond investment vehicle and should have been classified as income from that. You then undertook, or the finance team undertook a review of all income and identified a further adjustment of just over £500,000 in relation to what should be cash deposits should be reclassified as income for investment vehicles. So there's no change actually in the level of income, it's just a classification within the account, so there's no impact upon the overall bottom line effect. Turning on the page, our audit fee remains the same as published. We will be looking at potential additional fees for providing assurances to other auditors. I think we've got about 14 this year. I think we're maybe up to 16 now. I think they're very too late ones come in. But we will discuss that further with the finance team once we've completed all our work on that. And on page, in Appendix C, on pages 21 in your pack, which goes on to page 23, you have the draft opinion and, as I say, the consistency report as well. So overall, I'm going to say I'd like to express my thanks to Donna and her team. The audit is, as I say, substantially complete, and I'm proposing an unqualified opinion, but happy to take a question.
Any questions?
No.
Okay, well, thank you for that presentation. And
I don't know if you just want to quickly mention the next one because it has a letter of representation
yeah,
in it.
Yeah.
Just to say that because of the Fate of Bell work, it's a standard letter of representation. There have been no particular amendments to it. And I suppose paragraph 10 or X in there is where we make reference to you noting the change. In the classification, but it's not. We're not asking for any additional declarations this year, and I think you're then approving this for signing the audit risk.
So,
Councillor
Merseyside Pension Fund for 1718 and respond to the audit findings report from Grant Thornton. The statements of accounts are included with an MPF Strath Annual Report, which is Agenda Item 5, page 33 of the pack, with the statement of accounts commencing on page 64. The value of the fund, as noted, was 8.6 billion. I don't propose to go through the accounts at this meeting, but I am happy to take any further questions. The accounts have been subject to external audit over the summer and the previous item concludes the findings of that review. In response to the Grant Thornton report, officers have agreed to the suggested amendments to the disclosures. There were no adjustments that affected the bottom line figure. Overall, the Grant Thornton report is a positive report and reflects the hard work undertaken by fund officers. As Grant just alluded to, there is a letter of representation that has been prepared on behalf of this committee, which gives assurances to the auditor and various aspects of the pension fund. That letter will be presented to the Audit and Risk Management Committee and signed by Chair, the Director of Finance, and the Chair of that committee. Section 13 asks members of the Pensions Committee that, subject to clearance of outstanding matters, approve the audited statement of accounts for 1718. Consider the amendments to the accounts, the audit findings report and the letter of representation. Section 13 also asks members of the Pensions Committee that on approval and consideration of the previous point to refer the recommendation to the Audit and Risk Management Committee. Thank you, Chair.
Quite a comprehensive report in the draft format. Has anyone got any questions of it? We'll have to thank the report and recommend it for approval and to go to Audit and Risk Management.
Agreed?
Yeah. Thank you. Okay, and again, over to you, Donna, to talk through our vote out.
We can just go back to item agenda 5, which is the draft annual report, which just to note that recommendation is that members approve the draft annual report in accordance with Regulation 57.
Okay, we'll have to do that on here. Yeah, okay, thanks, Tom.
So, item 6 is the purpose of this report is to request that members note and approve the outturn for the financial year 2017-18 and the finalised budget for the financial year 2018-19. Members will recall the Pensions Committee received a paper in January on the budget and it was agreed that I would bring finalised figures to this meeting. The appendix of that reported in January is included as Appendix 2 in this paper. The actual outturn for the last financial year and the finalised budget for this coming financial year can be found as Appendix 1 to the report. The actual outturn for 17-18 is 18 million, which is lower than the original approved budget of 20.9 million and lower than that projected in the outturn 18.7 million as reported to committee in January. The finalised budget for 18-19 is 22 million and is the same as that reported in January. Section 2.3 of the report just highlights to members the updates that have been done since that reported in January. Section 2.5 reminds members that at an IMWP in June, CEM presented the most recent benchmarking report of MPF's investment costs. in the context of risk and return and relative to other funds, and this information is used by the fund and the Northern Pool to ensure effectiveness of the fund's expenditure in this key area. Section 7 of this report explains the costs of the pension fund are charged directly to the pension fund and are then ultimately recovered by investment income and employee and employer contributions. Section 12 recommends that members note the outturn for 17-18 and approve the finalised budget for 18-19.
Just an observation to relay my thanks and congratulations to the team for coming in under budget. It's so important that any money that's underspent goes immediately back into the fund to provide for members down the line. It's been a difficult number of years and the fund is still performing exceptionally well, and it's much cheaper than some of our peers out there. So thank you.
So, thank you for that comment. It's well made. So, members are happy to note the report of the outturn for 2017-18, and members approve the finalised budget for 2018-19. Are we agreed?
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you. Right, we're pleased once again to have with us John Raven, the Chair of our Pensions Board, and John is going to talk us through item 7.
Thank you, Chair. This is my third annual report to you as members of the Pensions Committee. Under the terms of reference, I'm required as independent chair of the Pension Board to prepare a report, to take that report to the board to agree, which is on the 13th of June, and then to bring that report to yourselves. If you look, turn over to project number 12, the table there covers the issues that the agenda item that we looked at in June of the year 2017-18. As in two previous years, we had a clear focus towards governance issues, and that's continued again. One particular area we looked at, I think, quite closely were the Investment Monitoring Working Party and the governance of this working party, minutes and agendas, and also members of the Pension Board attended those meetings on a number of occasions. At the March 2018 meeting, we discussed the nature and operation of the Investment Monitoring Working Party. We commended both the broad-ranging format in terms of the range of issues considered at each meeting and the overall representation at the IMWP, which includes the fund's investment consultants, the independent advisors, a range of fund officers, as well as the pension committee members. And the board would urge members of the pensions committee to attend that meeting as often as they're able. Turning to the governance and risk working party, that meets twice a year. We think that is an incredibly important body. Consider some big issues such as the risk register, business plan, internal audit reports. The minutes of that provided clear evidence of the consideration and discussion of those issues. We particularly noted that staffing issues have been discussed there, and I think that's again positive that the WRP is doing that. Another big element of the pension board's work was to look at pensions admin issues. We continue to receive detailed reports on the performance of the pensions admin team. I'd commend Yvonne and her team for the performance and the reports that we've received. We also had the opportunity to comment on, which we did, various policies, including the pensions administration strategy, and members of the pension board made a number of comments into that process, which were accepted by the officers and fined by the committee. We'd like to be in assistance there. The board was pleased again to note the proposed terms of reference of the joint committee, and particularly that it consists of six elected members and also three trade union representatives. We felt this reflected genuine intention by the board to possibly engage and involve employee representatives in the top level governance, and we felt that would add to the diversity of thought and avoid a grouping. And I have to say, as a former chief officer, I'm very clear in my own view that involving employee representatives in decision-making bodies is a very positive thing, and I commend the Merseyside Fund and the other two funds for doing that. Finally, I'd like to say that during the year we identified a number of issues on the law, and neither did the officer, so there was no need to report to the country of Belgium in that respect. And finally, as in previous years, the board is very dependent on received excellent support here from the Director of Pensions and all his staff. And on behalf of the board, I'd like to thank Peter and all the officers for their support. Thank you, John.
It is a comprehensive report, and I know John is very, very diligent in his attendance and chairing of the board. I know many of us know some of the board members who have come from excellent backgrounds and suitably qualified for the participation in the board, so grateful for that. And as you quite rightly stated, we're very fortunate to have the officers that we have within our fund. Has anyone got any questions of John?
Say thank you for the comprehensive support.
Yeah, thank you. He travels home tonight all the way to
Bedford.
Just to reinforce the comment about the quality of the INWP meetings, you know, they really are excellent. Mm-hmm. I would also like to congratulate officers for the quality of those workshops. They are very, very, very good and well worth attending.
Yeah. Thank you. Very good. Thank you. Okay, so we're happy to note the report and the recommendations and all the work that you do and your board members. Thank you. Okay, agenda item 8 is our usual update on the local government pension scheme, which Yvonne's going to talk us through.
This report updates members of the key changes impacting on funds administration brought about by the 2018 amendment regulations. These regulations came into force on the 14th of May, including new provisions and correcting errors within the current 2013 regulations. Section 2.2 notes the main changes for members is that pre-14 deferred benefits can now be accessed from age 55 without employer consent, and this includes council members' benefits. AVC contracts taken out pre and post 2014 have been harmonised, allowing members to contribute 100% of pay into an AVC, and funds must be disinvested at the same time as main scheme benefits. Section 2.3 notes the main changes in relation to employers is the ability to return surpluses to employers who exit the fund. As a result, there will need to be greater engagement between the fund, outsourcing employers and external contractors as to who will be responsible for picking up the liabilities on exit. The fund has met with finance directors of the main councils to discuss the impact of these changes on the commercial arrangements. Section 2.4 raises awareness that a number of provisions in the draft regulations have not been included in the final regulations, specifically New Fair Deal, although a further consultation will be issued later this year to iron out any anomalies identified in the draft regulations. Also, the option to draw down ABCs as cash lump sums prior to taking main scheme benefits hasn't been brought forward, and members who wish to consider this option will have to transfer their ABCs outside the LGPS to take them before the main scheme benefits. There's a statutory requirement under the disclosure regulations to notify members and employers of any material changes affecting benefits within 3 months of the change in position. Therefore, we're currently in the process of notifying all deferred members of the option to access benefits from age 55 without employer consent. This letter will also be used as an opportunity to promote the My Pension Member Portal to support the fund's digital communication strategy. And it also contains information how the fund complies with the Data Protection Act with regard to the legal basis for holding personal data and how we share that data. Employers have received an email alert informing them of operational changes relating to exit credits, pensionable pay calculations, and the need to review discretionary policies in these areas. Section 8 notes that the introduction of exit credits will require the fund to review and consult on the fund's strategy statement to align the termination policy with the amendment regulations. The recommendation is members note the report, but I'm happy to take any questions.
Anyone's got any questions for Yvonne? Okay, so happy to note the report as presented. Thank you. Okay, agenda item Guy is just going to talk us through where we are. There's a recommendation we need to adopt.
Thank you, Chair. This report provides members with an update of the Fund's progress in regard to compliance with the General Data Protection Regulations. The report also recommends for approval a data protection policy for the Fund. A draft of this policy has already been considered by the local pension board and deemed suitable for presentation to committee this evening. As members will be aware, the General Data Protection Regulations are a legal framework intended to boost the privacy rights of citizens and to strengthen the digital economy across the European Union. Last year, the government announced that it would implement the regulations and retain the legislation following Brexit, and the UK Data Protection Act 2018 received Royal Assent on the 23rd of May and came into force on the 25th of May in line with the European regulations. In paragraph 2.3 of the report, I can report that whilst there have been minor changes made to the UK implementation of the regulations, there are none that will directly affect the Fund's approach to compliance with the Act. In meeting that compliance, officers have worked with the local government association and legal counsel in preparing three key documents that can be used by all LGPS funds. As outlined in paragraph 2.6, there is a detailed privacy notice that clearly states to fund stakeholders what personal data we hold on individuals and the legal basis upon which we collect that data. This is attached as Appendix 1 to the report at page 135 of the pack. The collaborative working also developed a summary privacy notice, and this was included in a newsletter sent to over 49,000 pensioner members in March. We are currently providing a brief update to our deferred members and next month to the active members as part of the annual benefits day introduction. The third document developed has been a memorandum of understanding that has been shared with all participating employers. This sets out a legal basis to which employers can share personal member data with the Fund without the need for a data sharing agreement being in place. This document in particular has been useful in providing clarity to our scheme employers, and a copy is attached as Appendix 2 of the report. At paragraph 217, the Fund has developed a data protection policy, the purpose of which is to define our responsibilities under the Act and to provide reassurance to our members that their data is managed in compliance with the statutory obligations placed upon the Fund. For example, on page 150 of your pack, you will see that the policy outlines the Fund position in regard to six key data principles as listed in Part 3, Chapter 2 of the UK Data Protection Act. And on page 152, you'll see that the policy makes clear the legal basis for processing and further informs our members their rights in regard to the Fund's handling of their personal data. I draw members' attention to page 154, where the policy identifies myself as the Fund's Data Protection Officer, and also further down that page makes it clear that all employees, officers, pension committee and pension board members have a responsibility to report any security incident or data breach to me as quickly as possible, should it be connected to the work or data maintained by the Fund. Thank you for your consideration of this report and its appendices.
Yes, please. I appreciate that data protection legislation isn't designed to deal with any issues in this sector, because both in the public sector and the private sector, when it comes to financial institutions, tend to be very good with data protection. So I appreciate the audience isn't this institution, or any of our peers certainly in the public sector, very unlikely in the private sector. However, we have to bear in mind the risk that if something goes wrong, what is the extent of the liability? And in terms of the GDPR framework, and it pre-exists the existing legislation, or the pre-existing legislation, the fines, it's 4% of turnover or whichever is greater. Just for clarity, if we haven't got the information to hand, because for the reasons I've said, I don't think that we have been any discussion with the European Commission about this. This isn't Google, this isn't Amazon or some of these large enterprises that had slightly less rigorous governance and information. But is that 4% of turnover in terms of our contributions, or is it contributions plus earnings from investments, or is it the whole asset base, because they're quite different figures? So unless the information is handy, it might just be worthwhile having it come back to us at a future date.
Certainly, I mean, it's on page 132, it's quoted as being that the Data Protection Act has a potential for significant reputation damage, but the monetary risk is a maximum of €20 million. Okay, that's the maximum, or 4% of annual worldwide turnover, which at the time it hasn't been defined in regards to how it would be before. is significant, it will be at least 20 million euros, which is quite considerable. Mm-hmm. In regards to that exact definition, it hasn't been defined in regards to the pension industry, but I'm aware.
Let's hope it doesn't have to be.
Can I just highlight to, because I know a lot of work that goes into this, and I'm grateful for Guy and his team and what we do there. But we spoke about you at a meeting the other day, and we're grateful for the fact that you always ask good questions. And keep us on our toes. So the recommendations contained in section 13, we're happy to note that and the recommendations therein.
Yes.
Donna, our Treasury Management Report.
Thank you, Chair. This report presents a review of Treasury Management activities in the Merseyside Pension Fund for the 2017-18 financial year and reports any circumstances of non-compliance with the Treasury Management Strategy and Treasury Management Practices. On the 23rd of January 2017, this committee approved the Treasury Management Policy and Strategy for the year. As at 31st of March 2018, MPF had a cash balance of 53.2 million, all on instant access accounts. The overarching investment priority during the year was managing counterparty risk. Section 2.7 of the report highlights that over the 12-month period, the audit must calculate the cash performance to be 0.23% against a benchmark of 0.21%. Section 2.10 reports non-compliance with policy during the year. There were two incidences. The fund breached the deposit limit with its current bank, Lloyds, the self-imposed limit. This was due to the receipt of significant funds that the Treasury team was not made aware of. The issue was rectified the next working day with no financial disadvantage to the fund. The fund was also put into an overdrawn position overnight. This was due to significant transactions taking place on a given date and cash proceeds from the redemption of investments not being received when expected. This resulted in a financial loss to the fund of £7,582.41, as detailed within the report. Also stated within the report is that working practices were reviewed and updated immediately to further strengthen the control environment and prevent reoccurrence. Section 13 asks members of Pensions Committee to agree the Treasury Management Annual Report for 17-18. Happy to take any questions, thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Donna. Have you got any questions? Quite straightforward report. Happy to note it and the recommendation. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Right, agenda item 11, which Peter's going to talk us through with regards to terms of reference for Pensions Board.
Yes, thank you, Chair. The committee's already heard a report from the Chair of the Board. The board's been operating for 3 years. Currently, our terms of reference stipulate a minimum of 2 meetings a year, but the board, as you have noted from the report, has been holding 3 meetings. The pensions regulator has recently indicated that he feels that 4 meetings a year would be best practice, so the board is receptive to that. So we're proposing to change our terms of reference to indicate a minimum of 4 meetings for the pension board each year. And under section 2.4, we're also taking advantage of the change to introduce some changes to allow the scheme manager, which is Rural Council, greater discretion in the appointment and terms of membership of the board to achieve necessary representation and balance. If members approve the report, we're also asking you to recommend the changes which need to be approved by full council. Thank you, Chair.
Any questions? Just one question. I'm aware of the work that our Pensions Board do, and very, very good, and the members are very committed. Assuming that some of this will reflect in perhaps an upgrade in remuneration for the work that they do, going from 2 metres to 4 metres and all the work that's involved. Is it something you might consider?
Yes, it hasn't been discussed so far, but it's certainly something that we
should consider. Choosing to members, fees, or what members?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, yeah. it needs to be reflected upon if we're asking them to do more work.
Yeah.
Would we agree?
Yeah.
Agreed.
Yes. Okay, so if we've got no more comments on that, thank you. Right, we've got, I'm going to ask Peter just to talk through the next, agenda item 12, I'm jumping the gun. Guy, communication.
Thank you, Chair. In accordance with the regulations, the fund is required to publish a statement of policy concerning how it communicates with members and scheme employers. The communications policy was last changed in January 2012. The attached revised policy takes into consideration the move to more electronic communications with an increased use of technology by members and employers. The local pension board considered the draft policy at its meeting on the 13th of June and have deemed it suitable for presentation tonight. At paragraph 2.1, the fund has moved to electronically distributing annual benefit statements for active and deferred members. We've been able to make considerable savings in not printing and posting paper statements to everyone. Members are only provided with paper copies on request, and we now produce about 2,500 each year, significantly fewer than the 80,000 plus statements we produce electronically. In paragraph 2.2, you will see that we will continue to communicate to active and deferred members via a newsletter when the fund has to explain multiple complicated concepts, perhaps using diagrams and examples. For instance, the use of the V-Line newsletter to active members was useful in 2014 and 2015 for the communication of the new career average scheme and the then upcoming changes to the state pension. For our deferred members, there are more cost-effective means of communication as part of the annual benefit statement production. For instance, using a simple posted letter to members informing them of any regulatory change, how they can get more information via our website and the availability of their personal benefit statement online. For active members, we have been successful in providing employers with material for use on intranets, staff briefings and email broadcasts. We will continue to produce an annual newsletter for pensioners as it still proves to be a valued resource and allows us to maintain a dialogue with pension beneficiaries. This cohort is also less likely to engage with technology, but I'm sure we will see the rate of online engagement increase over the coming years. In paragraph 2.7, you will see that the updated communications policy is now shorter and more specific, as some items and references are now more appropriately referenced in other policy documents, and the revised policy is attached as Appendix 1 and starts at page 181 of the PAN. Thank you, Chair. Happy to answer any questions.
I'd just like to comment, for those people who've been onto the website for the pension fund, it's really, really good. It's very interactive. If you are a scheme member, I'd advise you to log on and just look around and see what it can do for you, what it can do for our employees. It's very, very good. It came to my light, actually, that most of the work from that was done in-house, so congratulations to Guy and his team for all the work that we do there. Has anyone got any comments or questions? Okay. So we're happy to note the report.
It is actually need to pre-raise our communications policy.
Do you want to just read that through and make sure we're doing what you want?
What we're actually asking is the committee approve the revised communications policy,
yeah,
which is attached to our page.
So we're happy to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair.
Okay, I'm going to ask Peter to just go through the next three items together, really, in as much as they are all training events, and I'd just like to add my weight to the fact that they're excellent events and they're something we should get involved in and support as best we can. So if Peter can just run us through quickly agenda items 13, 14 and 15, I'd be grateful.
Certainly, Chair. For the benefit of you members of committee, you don't have a statutory requirement to undertake training, unlike the pension board that do have a statutory requirement. But nonetheless, we've adopted the SIP for Knowledge and Skills framework with a view to members of committee having suitable knowledge and skills for undertaking pensions work. We bring an annual development policy to committee for approval, and then as events come up, we bring individual papers to committee. So as the Chair says, there are three different events that we're bringing to committee. The first one is the fundamentals training, which under our policy is recommended for new members of committee in particular to undertake before other events are undertaken, because it does lay a good foundation of knowledge over both investment and administration issues in the LGPS. If you look at page 190, you'll see that there are 3 days, so it is a big commitment of time, but there is the possibility to mix and match venues and dates in order to accommodate members' diaries. Section 8 indicates the cost, which is £260 per day, and that is a worthwhile event, particularly for new members, but also available for existing members to refresh their knowledge. The second item is the PLSA annual conference, which this year is being held in Liverpool, so it's a convenient venue. It is held over 3 days. I don't have an agenda yet, but I certainly recommend that even if members can only attend for a day or half a day, as it's on our doorstep, it's worth doing. I would just point out under section 2.5, although there's no cost to the fund for members to attend, there is a cost if members register and fail to attend. So I will circulate an agenda for that, as it's known that it's a good mix of both public and private sector pensions and a mixture of defined benefit and defined contribution. And then the final event is in September in Newport, South Wales. This is an LGBS specific event. Again, it's a good programme. It's for committee to determine whether they wish to send a delegation, but again, would encourage members to attend if possible. So, simplistically, fundamentals is the primary opportunity, the PLSA, if at all possible, and those that can spare a couple of days down in South Wales, then the LGC is a good event as well.
Emma will forward details of each of those training opportunities to all of us. So I'd just like to encourage the new members, if you can, go on, particularly the fundamental training events. Can you do get a shiny certificate at the end of the 3 days of effort? Thank you for that. Okay, our next agenda item is an update on GLIB, which again, Peter will talk us through.
Yes, thank you, Chair. There have been early reports to this committee on GLIL, which is the pooled infrastructure vehicle, of which the fund is one of five LGPS funds investing in it. Under section 2, I set out some of the background to the infrastructure platform. Since we invested back in November 2012, the nature of the investment has changed. It was originally a limited liability partnership. It's more recently become an alternative investment fund, the significance of which is that it's now FCA regulated, which means that other pools and other funds are able to invest in it alongside the founder members, and we're encouraging other pools and funds to do so. Along with that, the fund is asking members to agree to an increase in our allocation to it from 2% to 4%. Other members of GLIL are also increasing or intending to increase their investment in the vehicle. Currently there's £1.25 billion committed to it, of which £800 million is invested in UK infrastructure in a variety of investments such as the Clyde Wind Farm, a series of anaerobic digestion plants.